JazakAllah khair, Brother Nadeem. As always, words of wisdom, precise and brief and to the point, mashallah. Now we come to the last part of the program before we go to the question and answer session. As we live our lives as Muslims in a predominantly non-Muslim country, there are many challenges that will occur in situations where we put our Islamic practice, and then there are laws that will affect those particular decisions that we make, the laws that are the laws of the land. Divorce is one of those situations where many issues can arise. And we have our sister Saadia Sayeed. She is the daughter-in-law of a very dear friend of mine, Dr. Sayeed. She is an attorney. She moved here from Houston after her marriage. She's involved in CARE as one of the board members of CARE Georgia. She was practicing previously at the Atlanta Legal Aid Society, but then she gave that up in order to take care of her babies. So she has been a very devoted mother, an excellent attorney from what I've heard, with a heart that is towards helping, mashallah, the people who need her advice. So we'll have Sister Saadia come here and make a presentation on divorce in Islam. It's not going to be more the Sharia aspects of divorce that we can take up in the question and answer session. But this will be more about how the issue of divorce is looked at and impacted by the laws of the land. Sister Saadia.
This is a really excellent gathering. I have to say, I've never heard such a good talk on conflict resolution as Brother Nadeem just gave. So I have to say, alhamdulillah, this is really necessary. I don't know how many people here are single or married and just, you know, wanting to learn about Islamic perspectives on marriage. Either way, I think you're always learning. I'm seeing women take down notes, and I realize that no one is ever ready for how difficult marriage is. And I think I was very blessed in what challenges Allah's thrown my way. I am a divorce lawyer. I'm from Texas originally. I moved here when I got married about almost 8 years ago. I practiced family law here for 5 years with the Atlanta Legal Aid Society in DeKalb County. I don't want my talk to be too technical because I don't think that anyone here wants to memorize divorce law, but I did before I left my job about 2 years ago. I did regularly, you know, maybe numerous times a day, speak to people about divorce and what to expect from divorce. And I think it's useful for anyone, whether you're single or in a marriage and you have a great marriage, with, you know, because I think everyone obviously faces some challenges. And when you know what the other side of the coin is, it allows you to make better decisions in your marriage. I think then sometimes people realize that my marriage may not be easy, but the alternative is worse. I do think, I have rarely seen someone who divorced that's come to me that did it in jest or without really considering the ramifications. But I still don't think that means that they were prepared for the ramifications because people don't quite understand what's gonna happen with their children or the money in the marriage or the property or whether they'll get support or not. So let me go ahead and start, and if I leave anything out, I'm going to try to make it as palatable as possible. If I leave anything out, please feel free to ask me at the end, because I don't want to throw legalities at you that you don't really need to know. So typically when someone seeks a divorce, well, first let me say that if you are separated and you don't want a divorce, which is oftentimes something you see with religious people, they don't want to go get a divorce, but they don't want to be in the marriage really either, and the parties are living separately. Sometimes people will seek something called a separate maintenance action, which is where basically they're dividing things up for temporary use, like a home and a car, meaning who gets to use it. They'll have a judge decide that in that type of case. Also, they'll have some type of support set up. Okay, so there is a way to get these issues addressed without pursuing a divorce. But if someone was to pursue a divorce, also you can address who keeps the children and how often the other party sees them. So I'll kind of talk a little bit more about these issues as we go into the divorce process. So with divorce, there's about four or five different issues that are relevant to the average person. A property division, debt division, meaning who's gonna be liable to the creditors, who's gonna be liable on the mortgage, who's gonna be liable on the house, on the car payment, who's gonna keep the children and when, and who gets that right? Because oftentimes when people divorce, You oftentimes there's one party that's really unhappy about it, one party that initiated it that's very happy about it, or you know, even if they're, it's very acrimonious and they're angry about it, one party seeks to move forward with it. Typically in Georgia, so we do understand we're talking about a court case, so there's going to be a judge who's going to make a determination. And typically in Georgia, the court will determine who gets the kids most of the time by looking at who has had the kids most of the time. Okay, so that's kind of gives you an idea about who would likely keep children after the parties have separated and you've gone to court for a divorce or a separate maintenance case. So what happens is the court will then give one party the children most of the time and the other parent will get what's called visitation. Typically in Georgia, the five metropolitan counties, at least in Atlanta, the courts would typically give the other party every other weekend, usually a first, third, and fifth weekend visitation schedule. You know, I was lucky enough and I was very privileged. I worked in DeKalb County with Atlanta Legal Aid Society and I had a lot of Muslim applicants. And of course, I'm happy to help anyone, I'm sure just as any Muslim here is. But it was nice because I think a lot of them were immigrants and they would look to me as kind of an older sister. I think it's a different relationship almost that a lot of immigrant women want with their lawyer than like say an American woman or say I would want with my lawyer. So it's very nice. I was able to kind of give them more advice and be more of a counselor than I even typically am for an average client. For an average client, I do give a lot of counseling because they don't understand the ramifications of the choices that they have to make. And what happens is moms sometimes say, oh, well, good, I get the kids, and that's great. You know, I took care of the kids most of the time, and thank God this is a fair country, and this is not like back home, you know, wherever they may be from, in Africa or this Asian subcontinent or some other place, and they're concerned about what will happen with the children. But you know, it's a difficult process because you have to remember that when your children are going over to the ex's house, whether it be the mom or the dad, you can't control what's going on there. You have no control over how they parent. As long as they're not abusing or neglecting the child, child's going over there. The moms or even the fathers who I've represented who have said, well, you know, I don't want to send my kids over there. I don't like how they get fed, or I don't like the new wife or the new husband. You don't have a choice. And the parents who even have sometimes another parent or the other parent is less active or less interested in the child, that's just as bad for the child because the child is entitled to have two caring, loving parents. So that's one thing I see that's very common. So divorce can be very, very difficult for moms. And it's interesting because I always did all my divorce cases prior to becoming a mother and custody. I'm a contested custody lawyer and I would go to court and have these big contested cases where they wanted custody, one party wanted custody, the other party wanted primary custody. And now as a mom, I understand all the and I'm a very laid back mom, but you still as a mother are concerned about everything going on with your child, what they're being fed, how often they're being fed, whether they're getting formula or natural milk, you know. It's really something that I think, you know, you learn to appreciate when you are a mom. Property division, I'll go to that and answer anything specific about custody if anyone likes to talk about that in a little bit, and we'll discuss alimony too. So property and debts, and this is kind of something that I saw, my parents are from the Pakistani Indian subcontinent originally, and we're all, I think, are Americans now, a lot of us are born and raised here as well. But I was gonna say that my parents' generation, I think the understanding was, your husband made the money, it was his money. And that's not the case at all. In American law, and either party earning during the marriage is basically marital money, meaning it would be divided equally as long as the judge didn't have a significant problem with either party, meaning as long as either party did not commit any malconduct to cause the end of the marriage. And even then, the court will say, for example, one party can prove the other party committed adultery, or one party can prove that the other party was physically violent towards them, or that they neglected them, or that they were imprisoned during the marriage. These are things that are considered fault grounds in Georgia. So that would show bad conduct on behalf of one party. So even if that can be established, the court would still likely give 55% to the party that was wronged and 45% to the other party. Because, you know, this is something I always have to explain to my clients too. Divorce in Georgia is not about justice. This is not the criminal system where anyone's trying to get justice. We're not trying to punish people here. It's about putting people in a position to move forward with their life. So sadly, I have, and this I think was nice for me as a Muslim and to have Muslim clients at my offices explain to them that you're not going to get justice in the courtroom, you get justice from Allah. And I do think, inshallah, you will see your justice even in your lifetime. But that's the case with divorce, is that if you've been wronged, No one's going to make it up to you. You just have to move forward. And the court will do what's in the child's best interest when the court is determining how much visitation the other party gets, who gets physical custody, and those types of determinations regarding the children. Also, child support would be issued and be given to the party who has the kids most of the time. And that is determined based on both parties' income. In Georgia, we have a calculation where both parties' income go into an online calculator, and then the number comes out. And there's little tweaks you can do to it, and some of it are actually pretty significant tweaks, but generally speaking, that's how Georgia determines child support, and that would be issued as well. I guess I'm trying to avoid going into technicalities, understanding that this is more of a marriage seminar, not so much people trying to go get a divorce tomorrow, hopefully. And of course, anyone who wants to speak with me about any of this is welcome to approach me after, because I usually have, you know, it's so interesting as being a Muslim nonprofit attorney and being pretty well known in the community because my in-laws have been here for many years. And I'm from Texas, where I was born, and I knew a lot of people in Houston as well, but a lot of Muslims, mashallah, in Houston. But pretty much every gathering I go to, I have somebody take me aside and ask me what to do. And that's why, on some level, I see myself as someone who knows a little bit about marriage. Not a lot, but a little bit. Because I see a lot of common issues within our community. Alhamdulillah, I'm so impressed that Brother Yusuf and whoever else was able to put this together. I just had Brother Yusuf as my contact, but I'm sure, alhamdulillah, there were so many very, very, just great people putting this together, because I will tell you, a lot of these issues, it's almost like they're approaching me for a legal solution to something they know there is no legal solution to. You know, I'm a divorce lawyer. I'm going to tell you, get a divorce. You know, do you want me to solve a problem for you? But unfortunately, sometimes there's no easy solution to difficult marital problems. And I will tell you, the way that I grew up, I'm pretty vocal about it too, because the way that I grew up, we would go to these parties and everyone's dressed up and everyone's having a great time, and there's no real discussion about what's really happening in anyone's marriage. It's all, everyone's kids are doing good and everyone's married for the sake of being married. You don't really know much else. It doesn't go any deeper than that. And so our generation, I think, we see our parents and how they live their marriage, and oftentimes our marriages are very, very different. So we don't want to model exactly what they did, because our ideas of marriage and love are very different. Let's see, what else can I tell you? And going along with what Brother Nadim was talking about, is there are different grounds in Georgia for divorce. There's also a non-fault grounds, which is called irretrievably broken. Meaning you would just tell the court, our marriage is irretrievably broken. So the court's not going to say anyone did anything wrong. And this is funny, this is something people ask me often too, that I'm sure everyone's wondering. If one party wants a divorce, can the other party still get one? I mean, can the other party resist and say no and refuse the divorce? No, that doesn't happen in the United States. So if one party wants a divorce and takes the other one to court, and the other one says, Your Honor, I don't want a divorce, the court's going to say, sorry, pal, you're getting a divorce. I will tell you, I've also had a frustrating experience where I had a Muslim woman who came to me for a divorce, and we even got a finding of cruelty in the divorce. Which, by the way, a judge making a finding of a fault in Georgia is also very uncommon. I mean, they do it, but they don't do it very frequently. So that was really nice. We had it on paper, and I think it gave her a sense of vindication. And I tried to find an imam in the community, and I'm not extremely connected. Let me say, I don't know, anyone. I'm not approaching people every day or anything. I just approach a few people, and I could not find an imam that would grant a divorce to a woman who has a finding of cruelty, because she wanted to get an Islamic divorce. Let me explain that a little further, because I haven't discussed it. So divorce that I'm talking about through the American legal system is a civil divorce. And as we know, Islamically, we believe we also need an Islamic divorce, because they're two very different things. Now, I'm not at all well-versed, or I don't really know a whole lot about Islamic divorce, but I do understand that if a woman wants to get it and her husband refuses, she can go and seek one from an imam, and he would assist her in giving her one. So anyhow, that's kind of part of the process as well, is that if someone seeks a divorce, obviously they want to get it done through the courts so that they have all their legal issues in order, and they can enforce alimony if they get it, or child support if they get it. Let me go back to the property and debt. So any property that's acquired during the marriage is generally marital, meaning it's both parties. It doesn't matter if your husband's at work 14 hours a day and you're home doing nothing and you have any kids. It doesn't matter. If you're out shopping 24 hours a day, it's marital. Both parties, it's considered the equitable property of both parties. And the court will typically split it up, but that's assuming there's some in the account, right? Because oftentimes whatever we earn, we've spent. That's the same for debts. Is typically speaking, whatever debts were incurred during the marriage are also marital, meaning the court will split them up. Now, how does the court, let's say example, for example, you go buy a car from the Toyota dealership. How does the court split up a debt you owe to the Toyota dealership? Well, essentially what the court will do is the court will say you're both liable for half, and then when Toyota sues one of the spouses for the remaining money, meaning whoever's name is on the contract, they can come to court now and say, Your Honor, I had to pay this to Toyota, or Toyota's suing me, can you make her pay? Now, it's not a great process because in the United States, we don't put people in jail for not paying. So all you can really do is get a court order again that says they owe you the money that has interest accruing on it. Now, eventually, the good thing is we can garnish wages, meaning if this person has a regular job, you can use that judgment and go garnish their wages, meaning get a certain percentage out of their income every week. And this also applies to alimony and child support. Let's see. So alimony is also something I get a lot of questions on. Regarding alimony, what happens is one party says, Your Honor, we were married. I can no longer go get a high-paying job, and I need some money to support myself. And the court will look at whether the other party, first of all, earns enough money to pay. The other party's earning a minimum wage at McDonald's 40 hours a week. It doesn't have any money to pay you alimony, so that's already an issue. The court will look at the length of marriage, whether or not you really cannot go get a job and earn, you know, and earn for yourself and support yourself, whether one party is disabled or not. I've had a lot of luck getting alimony whenever I seek it, but I also look for it when the other party is really wealthy enough. I mean, that's to me the main issue. If the other party has something to give, you can always get it for some period of time, whether it be a few months or a few years. Let me go quickly mention to you how divorce works. Or, like I was talking about, a separate maintenance action. Someone wants to seek a separate maintenance action or a divorce action. The first thing is you'd have to be separated from your spouse. Now, sometimes people are still living in the same home, but as long as you're not resuming marital relations, as long as that's not going on, and you can truthfully tell the court you are separated, meaning you do not intend to be married to this person any longer, that's considered a separation for purposes of Georgia law. Then what happens is once you've established that you're separated, the person who seeks a divorce would go file a complaint, what we call a complaint for divorce, in the county where the other party resides. Okay, so what happens is then at that point, you have somebody take those papers and serve it on that person, meaning usually it's a sheriff or a private process server will take those papers and go give it to the other party and say, here you go. Now, if you have a cooperative spouse, you can have him waive it and hand it to him or her. And there's such thing as a waiver, and it's something you can give from the courthouse. After the complaint is filed, the other party has 30 days to file a response. Now, if you don't file a response in any lawsuit, that's a major problem. You're forfeiting all your rights. So please, everyone remember that for any case that's ever presented to you. If you think you're being sued in any court, you can always look it up online. This is not just for divorce, this is anything. It's not 100% reliable, but I've always found it reliable. You can look it up online and say, look up your name and see if you've been sued. It's always useful to know if you've been sued. Now that's not happening to everybody behind your back. I mean, you would typically know about it. But if you have a reason to believe, you're receiving a letter in the mail or something that concerns you. But they have to serve you under American law, meaning you have to get it. It's proper service. It's considered due process, meaning you can't be expected to know about it unless you've been given it a certain way. So that party then has 30 days to file a response. Now, Georgia can be frustrating because there's something called there's no such thing as a default divorce in Georgia. I mean, you cannot forfeit your rights in a divorce case, no matter what. But if you never know about it and you never show up to the hearings, then you have effectively given up your rights. So divorces in Georgia do take a good long time sometimes. I mean, it can take 6 months, it can take a few years, I have to say. It's very frustrating to be, I'll tell you as a mom now too, it's funny because I reflect on it, and having seen my clients go through it, custody cases are very, very taxing and very, very upsetting and very, very worrying. I mean, it's your children. And oftentimes the other party, maybe they weren't even interested in having physical custody of the kids most of the time, but because you want it and they're mad at you now, they're looking for it. Or, you know, they're seeing suddenly new bad qualities in you that they never really saw before, and they want to protect their children from those bad qualities. Now, just so everyone knows also, if you ever get into a situation where you're filing a custody case or a divorce case or a separate maintenance action and something comes up, immediately upon filing, you can ask the court for a temporary hearing. Okay, so the court typically is going to say, okay, you file the case, we're going to give you a final hearing whenever we have time, right? You can't be our first priority. We have a lot of other people that have filed before you. But the way that you get around that, and the way that you get the court to say who gets to use the car, who gets to use the house, who gets to have, you know, little Ahmed on Monday, and who gets to pick him up from school instead of it being a race to the school every day, basically you ask the court for a temporary hearing. And at the temporary hearing, you ask the court to give you temporary alimony if you need it, temporary spending money, temporary child support if you're keeping the child. You ask the court to give you temporary custody of the children or temporary visitation. Maybe you don't want custody. Maybe you want the other party to have it, but you want to visit your child regularly the way that you believe is you're entitled to. So the court will give you a temporary hearing. I will tell you, in Georgia, they're really bad about it. It's very frustrating because there's no due process unless you can get a judge to make an order. Otherwise, you're both fighting, you know, you're both emptying at the bank accounts or pawning items that you both own. I mean, it can be very, very unfair if the court won't address it. So temporary hearing is really useful. During the course of divorce, separate maintenance, or even any lawsuit, pretty much, any civil lawsuit, you have the opportunity for mediation, which is where you can go to basically usually a third party, a third party's office, and there'll be a mediator there. And their job is to talk with both parties and to try to come to a resolution on the issues that are disagreed upon. That can be very useful because I will tell you, even though I have rarely, rarely seen an unfair order, which is good news because these are children that we're talking about, and you always want to be able to tell the parents, look, it's almost never that they make a bad order for the kids. It's not going to be something that's not in their best interest. Even if you don't like it, it will generally be in their best interest. Excuse me. It is always better to settle the case yourself and to end it on terms that you choose, as opposed to letting someone else decide. I mean, I've seen judges make lifelong decisions in 5 seconds, and that happens every day. I mean, it's shocking. And I will tell you, there's some very bad judges. Most of them are very good, but there are some very bad judges. I mean, incumbents really do just keep winning. I used to practice in DeKalb County, and one or two judges were notoriously bad. And you knew if you were going to be in that courtroom, your client was going to get a bad result. And every lawyer would settle every case for that reason, because no one knew whether they were going to be on the good side of the judge or the bad side, which was the only advantage of being in the court. Okay, and so guys, why does a lawsuit take a long time? Why does a divorce case take a long time? Because the lawyers need an opportunity to collect information. The reason they need an opportunity to collect information is so they can present evidence to the court, so the court can establish what the facts are in this case, so the court can make a decision. Meaning, is it true that he beat her and she beat him, or is it true that only he beat her? Is it true that the kids were with her most of the time, or is it true that she burned them, you know, repeatedly, she allowed them to get burned? You know, these types of things. The court would need that evidence to make a good decision. So the lawyer's job is to send out certain tools of information seeking that we do as lawyers that are written. Sometimes we do depositions, which are questioning people. In addition to that, we also can subpoena witnesses for court, bring witnesses that will establish information. And I'll tell you, it's funny, because a lot of my cases did go to trial. I mean, divorce cases really do, they are highly contested, they're very emotional. They say sometimes family law judges are even more in danger than criminal law judges, because people are so emotional when it comes to family issues. Let me see if there's anything else I want. Okay, sorry, I wanted to end with talking about family violence. So I want to say, I can't tell you how many times I've had people approach me at parties and say, he hit her, but we don't want her, we want her to try. You know, they have a kid, let them try. Well, I will tell you, I don't judge anyone for staying. It's a very difficult thing, and I understand the process completely. They feel really guilty. They feel pity for the other person who's been abusing them. It's not just that this abuser's abusing, it's that they've known this abuser for many, many years. They have a good side. They're really sorry. You know, they cry every time. And this is something people don't quite understand, but it's very, very common. The problem is, I have also learned, because I predominantly deal with domestic violence victims, at Atlanta Legal Aid Society, where I worked, I didn't get paid by any of my clients. So oftentimes, these people don't have their own income. That's oftentimes, sometimes, why they stay in a marriage where they're being abused. So they would come to us to get a protective order. Protective order is an order the court gives you that prevents a person from coming close to you, showing up at places that you go to, controlling you monetarily, okay, when someone's been abusing you. And I'll talk to you about that quickly. I know that I'm almost out of time. But basically, I will tell you, the thing that I always remember is I've very rarely seen an abuser stop abusing. And I will tell you this too, this is something not everybody understands. Maybe single people don't understand it. Maybe people in good marriages don't understand it, even though I think every marriage has some big challenge. It changes the whole dynamic of the entire relationship. It doesn't just affect that hour or that day. It changes everything. I mean, I can't tell you like what the privilege I had working with minorities at DeKalb County, and anyone that needed help, was being able to explain to them what they're entitled to. You know, as women, as Muslims, as people, right? As men. I mean, I've actually seen abused men, if you can believe that. It does happen. So people who are disadvantaged, oftentimes they're undocumented men. But basically what you realize is that it affects everything. It really does. And so it's something that we need to, as a community, voice. We need to say it's not acceptable. Under any circumstances, it's not acceptable. And if anyone ever deals with it, you need to immediately go get an ex parte temporary protective order. Now, what the way that works is, so you think, okay, I have to go to court and get an order. So what you basically do is you can go to any number of domestic violence assistance centers, and they'll help you fill out the paperwork. You'll go to the courthouse alone. They won't be there. And the court will ask you, what are you doing here? What do you need? And all you have to prove to the court is that there's been physical violence, threats of violence, or stalking in the past. That's me generalizing, but that's generally what it means. And that it may occur again. That's all you have to prove, and the court will sign it right there. The court will set it for a hearing within 30 days where the other party has to come, and those papers that you just, that the court just signed, will get served on the other party. So he'll know about it. He can't come, typically it's like within 500 feet of your home, the children's school. The court can address who gets temporary custody of the kids. The court can address temporary child support. The court can address temporary support, meaning she can ask for a little bit of alimony. So if she's someone who's not earning any money, she's just home with the kids, which is a very common scenario among the Muslim population. The court can order these things. The court can kick him out of the home in that order. Now, I've had this happen to a battered woman, where the husband immediately ran to the courthouse, got a TPO against her, kept the kids. And that was a very challenging case, but alhamdulillah, we were able to prove that she was the abused. But I can't tell you how hard it is sometimes. I mean, it's very hard because you have a lot of people who are lying to the court regularly about these types of allegations. And it's, I know, Allah help the one who didn't do it, who's accused of it, because that's also a very difficult thing. Let me go ahead and just conclude, and if anyone wants to ask questions of me specifically, I can answer them.